I will call her a radio legend and a television legend. Well, I was just in here earlier, but I was talking to a guy that's in town for Stern Mill Festival, and he asked me what I was doing, and I said, I'm doing a podcast. So I'm a little nervous because it's Sherrie McCutcheon. He goes, I know who that is. and then somebody hooked you up with a coffee.
Yeah, my good friend Bob Kennan did. How blessed am I, right?
So you're very well known in town, and I would say I'm a lovely figure.
Aw, thank you.
Well, I was excited that you're coming on here because I had been on your show a couple times.
Yeah.
We talked about earlier, and now you're on my show, and I'm the student, you're the master. Usually I have to tell the guests to not be nervous, but you might have to tell me.
Oh, no. You know, it's so funny being on the other end. This is very different for me. Yeah, I'm used to being the one in control, the one that has the questions, that, you know, and now it's like, I don't know what you're going to throw at me. Be kind.
Well, you were always very kind to me when I was on the air. I came on, I think, maybe three times.
Yeah.
In film projects, and you always sent me these, you know, I was nervous maybe the first minute or two, and then you and Lola start rolling with me. And
yeah.
I have to tell you, always a pleasure. In my car listening to you and Lola.
Aw, thank you.
I didn't even watch the show, but I enjoyed the conversation.
Yeah, we were passionate about that.
And I think that's why it was interesting. You guys were passionate about everything that you would talk about. And you guys were really personal and talk about things that really meant a lot to you. And you guys kept it real, as they say.
I believe that's what you need to do. Trying to pull off a persona, and especially when you live in a small town, I mean, people can call BS real quick. And I have no problem being vulnerable with people. A lot of people say, you know, you're supposed to have this image. Well, you know, I have an image that I aspire to be, but you're, you know, you, and you want to, you know, kind of fake it till you make it, but we're all human, and being part of fully human is flaws and all.
Yeah.
You know, so.
And I'm finding that I think that's what people respond to more now than ever. I say this all the time over here, but with Facebook, people put the image that they want people to see. Even I do. And I don't post the worst pictures of me. I pick out like the three best pictures ever taken of me, and those are my profile pictures. I think that's pretty common.
Yeah.
Some people maybe share everything in their life, but for the most part, we kind of put an image out there, and that's a lot of communication today. So I think people are looking for authenticity, and I think that's why podcasts have become so popular, because people just sit around and just chat, and it's a normal conversation between people. I think people even miss being part of a conversation, so they like to listen into an interesting conversation.
Right.
Because they don't need to have one.
I agree. I agree wholeheartedly. And I think that we need to bring back conversation. And conversation, not small talk. And there's a difference. I'm not good at small talk. I am miserable at small talk. Put me in a, you know, a networking event. Hi, my name. Oh, my gosh. But get me one-to-one with someone, and I want to go for the soul right there.
Yeah, you get to find out what the person's really about.
Yeah.
That's one thing I love about this, because I sit down with people that I've known for a long time, and I get to ask them questions that would not really work in a small talk situation. Even a casual conversation in a bar, to ask them a bunch of questions about their life.
Right. Yeah.
But to have a deep conversation with someone who you don't know that well, like we've met several times, we're going to have a chance to go to talk in a way that we never did before, and I'm really looking forward to it, because as much as I know about you, there's a lot I don't know.
Yeah.
So I'm going to, no hard questions. But just
that's all right.
Curious questions.
Okay.
And so you were on television first, and that was probably when I was living out of town.
Yeah, I started in 1984 at WTOV. I started off first year doing weather.
Okay.
They called me the weather bunny. I didn't want to be in weather, but you know, you do what you want to do to get your foot in the door. Now, looking back at it, I probably should have stayed in weather. I would have had a much more, I would have had a greater opportunity for my personality to come through, I think. You know, you have to stay unbiased and very serious as a newscaster most of the time. And weather, there's a lot of opportunity, to be more playful, not so serious and whatnot. But that's hindsight, and it is what it is. I just wanted to be the anchor. That was the goal I was going for. I wasn't looking at really the opportunity that I had, other than it was a foot in the door.
Which is, happens to a lot of people.
Yeah, that's youth.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I oftentimes feel like I've missed opportunities, and I think a lot of the good things that have happened to me have been dumb luck. They just have fallen into my lap. So I guess it's a matter of a little bit of luck, a little bit of just working hard, and a little bit of good opportunities. So how long were you in the TV station?
16 years.
Wow.
Yeah. After that first year, I moved into the main anchor spot. And I don't know if you remember the name Red Donnelly, but he was a legend. I mean, a legend in local broadcasting. And here I was, this 24-year-old kid with this legend in broadcasting. But he was so gracious, so kind, so loving, and so tolerant of my young stupidity. In my young opinions, you know, you imagine yourself at 24 and you think you know it all, you know, and he was so gracious, and I'm surprised he didn't roll his eyes at me. You know, I think back and I think, oh gosh, you were so tolerant of my stupidity. But I was very blessed to be side by side with this legend.
So you took the anchor desk at 24.
Mm-hmm.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
When I was 24, that had to be tough, because now all of a sudden, at a very young age, you're recognizable around that. Was that weird to, you know, you're probably used to it by now, but I'm sure all of a sudden you would, everywhere you went, they're shared. Everybody knew your name.
Well, you know, it was and it wasn't, and I'll tell you why. When I did all my internships, all my summer work at WTRF through college, okay? And I really thought that that's where I was going to be going to work. It didn't happen. They didn't have any openings. It was WTOV at the time had the opening. But back then, not a lot of people down here watched it. It was Wheeling News and Steubenville News. So I went upriver. I was more known upriver than I really was down here. But then that changed. You know, we brought in new management, new direction, and then we finally were in a ratings war, and we won. I mean, we were so far below, and then we finally won. I was part of that movement, which was very exciting. But and then the name recognition came, but it really didn't come at 24.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's been such a bad thing.
Yeah.
It's something that I find interesting. Independent films, we definitely not that well known. But when we do have a premiere event, I meet a lot of people, and that's so uncomfortable. But people come up and talk to me that they probably know a little bit more about me than them, or I just can't remember all the names of people I met in one night. And it's only for one day, and
right.
It all dies off after a while. But even just that little bit, it was a little bit hard for me to take, like, is it weird, like when you go to like the grocery store and hey Sherrie?
I've become a little more accustomed to it. It doesn't happen as much now because I was on television for 16 years. I've been off for 17. So I've been off longer than I have been on. But it's still funny how people say, I watch you every night, and I'm thinking, I haven't been on for 17 years, but God bless you. But it was exciting at first. I think it's kind of like akin to a musician hearing your record on the radio, you know what I mean, for the first time. And it was exciting. But then more and more people were coming up. And like I said, I'm not good at small talk. So I'm basically an introverted person. I have a personality that's introverted. I get me in front of a microphone or a camera, I do much better, or even a crowd. So it was very challenging for me to have small talk conversations. So I just tried to be gracious and kind. But I really didn't have much to say because I didn't know what to say. Isn't that? Yeah, it's an awkward feeling. And it always has been. But it's one of those things where you just learn to adjust. The more you do it, the more you practice, the better you are.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because I mean, you come into their homes on TV or on the radio,
they feel like they know you.
Yeah. And they feel like they know, especially on the radio when you're talking about so many things that are personal, and So they're coming to you like they feel like they know you, and you have no idea who they
right,
are.
Right, right.
I don't know. It's something that I've always found interesting about, I guess, celebrity.
Mm-hmm.
So this first time I got a chance to actually ask somebody that's been in that position. Because I know, I think the very first time I met you was at the Friends of Towngate meeting, and even I was like, oh, that's Sherrie McCutcheon. Can I go up and say hi? Of course, you
absolutely, yeah, I'm a normal person.
Yeah, and then since then, every time I run into you, which I think mostly is around town, maybe,
yeah.
Yeah, I'm like, yeah, Sherrie's just a normal person. And speaking of Towngate, you do the improv group.
Yes.
How did you get involved?
Left
in that?
To center. You know what? It started when we were having Tim on the broadcast,
okay, right.
And Lola and I, it was selfish. Lola and I are like, we've always wanted to do comedy. Will you start something with comedy? And he just had really come into a new position down there, and he's, oh, I don't know, you know. And over the years, every time he would come on, we'd say, what about that comedy? We would love to do, you know, sketch comedy or improv or something. Can you offer courses for adults? You know, because Towngate's very... What, it's awesome.
It's incredible.
But for someone like me who, you know, that's where everyone's shocked. I've never been in a play before, ever. Not even in high school was I in a play. I would love to do that, something like that. But I'm not going to try out when I've never been on stage before. Could we get some adult classes, you know? And he would say, that's something to think about. So it started as improv classes that he said, listen, after, and this was like 3 or 4 years after we had made the suggestion, I'm ready to do this. Let's get some classes. And so then it was just who kept coming back to the classes, and that's kind of who stuck with the troupe. And
wow.
Then we decided to do a performance, and that's how that started.
I love the performances. I think they're great.
Thank you.
And you're incredible. You're,
really?
Yes, yes. You, Ryan Sears, Mario, Mindy, gosh, I know I'm moving people up, but yeah, I mean, you stand out. Because I remember one time that I went, it was maybe a year and a half ago, and I walked out, I'm like, they said, how was I? I said, Sherrie was the best one. Sherrie and Brian were the best one.
Oh, you're kidding me.
Yeah. I mean, you were very natural, very funny, yet you're right about Tim and Townsley. What a great music.
Oh, we are so blessed in this small community to have something like that.
There would be no independent films if it wasn't for Tim Thompson. When I first said I wanted to do films, my friend Marianne had a meeting with Tim, which I didn't know really anything about him or Townsley.
Uh-huh.
He could have been a jerk for all I knew, and I was really nervous, so I was well prepared, and he'd sit down and talk to me like we were brothers. And
mm-hmm.
After that, when I was first getting started, we did a interview every other month, and he'd read my scripts and give me advice, and he was always very humble. So, I don't really know anything about film, but here's what I can tell you that I do know, and he just so much information. Even brunch and cash parties he would invite me to, and listening to them talk about, he talked about things that came up as a director, and other directors would talk about issues through the production, which they'd be laughing about having But it was a big education for me.
Yeah.
And they just been really helpful costumes. They let us film in the lobby, and they showed our movies there. It's an incredible resource that gives people the opportunity to do things. Which reminds me, speaking of opportunities, independent films is about giving people opportunities to act. We would love you to come and, you know, do something.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That would be fun.
I think you would be great.
Oh, thank you.
We'll have to part for you.
All right.
And they did a dad joke competition at the Little Theater. And afterwards, I was talking to some of the guys, and we're trying to put together a stand-up comedy open mic night where everybody comes up and does like a 3 or 5 minute set. So if you think that that's something you might want to...
Oh, boy.
I know, that's going to be the scariest thing that you can do as far as performance, because there's the only way to judge success
is if someone laughs.
If they laugh.
Mm-hmm.
If they don't laugh, you can practice, you can work on it as much as you want, and it can just be a bad audience that can get you.
Oh, wow. I don't know. That's okay.
So then you went off to radio.
Yes. I left.
Your first radio?
When I was in college, you were supposed to take a nice, healthy balance of both. And I'm like, I am not going into radio, so I'm not taking anything in radio. And then I end up with a 10-year, 10 or 12-year, I can't remember, something like that. The jury's still out on it. No one can seem to figure out how long I had a radio show. But I wasn't interested in being a DJ, but I really liked the talk format because you're able to get to the meat.
Right.
You know, when you're in television, you're 10-second sound bites.
Yeah.
You live in a world of 10-second sound bites. Well, you really can't learn a lot from 10-second sound bites. So I loved this. I loved this, and the timing was right. I, for people who don't know, I left television after the death of my second son, and I wanted to go home and heal and raise my 3-year-old. And I figured I have a better chance of getting back into TV, if that's what I want to do, than I do to have a young son. So I wanted to spend time with him. And at the time that he was ready to go off to school is when this opportunity came about. And it was perfect because it was 10 to noon.
Yeah.
So I could take him to school, go in and do my show, run my errands, pick him up from school, and be mom the rest of the day. After he was in bed, that's when I would prep for my show the next day. So he really never knew me as a working mom, although I was one.
Yeah, you could truly have it all. Right?
Yeah, so it worked out beautifully. And I loved my time at WKKX. I did. And I loved Lola, and then I loved Kelly. And it was wonderful because we always said our show was called The Broadcast,
right.
Which is, you know, at first some people were really put off by that. I loved the name.
Yeah, I do too.
And it was news and current events from a woman's perspective. It wasn't to the exclusion of men. It's just that we look at things a little differently. It was from our view as mothers, as working mothers, as middle-aged women, you know, and eventually as menopausal women, you know, whatever stage we were in life. I just loved that show.
And I think that's a good point. It was from a feminine point of view, but it was definitely listenable to anybody. But I think it was good that it kind of gave that viewpoint, because that doesn't get out there very often.
It's not represented very well on talk radio, especially.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
There are very few talk radio hosts that are female. I noticed when I first did my podcast, I think the first 10 episodes were all guys. And I said, wow, I need to get some women on here. And now lately, it's been more women.
Really?
And they actually do better with the downloads. I think they're better talkers. I don't know.
Well, maybe.
In fact, we were talking, we did the comic book podcast a couple weeks ago, and it was all guys. And we thought, there are 50% of the women, the readers of comic books are women. Why don't we have women on the page? So we're going to do another one, and the next one we're going to have more women on. But yeah, that was always good to get that point of view. And,
mm-hmm.
And it was just such a listenable show. It was...
Thank you.
To listen to, and you guys were always really sweet. And you did always talk about the death of your son. You really opened yourself up in a big way to the public like that. That's
mm-hmm.
really courageous. A lot of people would not necessarily be able to do that. And I think it's really great because I'm sure a lot of people have had similar experiences.
Sure.
We've all had loss. So for you to speak so openly about that had to be a cathartic experience for a lot of people.
It was for me, and it's just a part of my life. But what I wanted to let people know is this can be a part of your life without having to define your life. I think that if you look at me and if you ask anybody, there's not going to be too many people who say, that's Sherrie McCutcheon, the woman who lost her son. That happened in my life. But it's not my full life.
Right.
And there's so many people who get stuck in that definition of who they are now. I'm a widow. I am a mother who lost a child. And that becomes who they've transitioned into. And sometimes it's because they're afraid to let go for fear that if they don't constantly talk about that, they're dishonoring the loved one. Or that people might think they don't love them anymore. Someone really helped me through this, and it was something that just I can't even tell you. It was the power of a card in one person who was just an acquaintance. And she kind of put it in perspective to where it all made sense for me and I was able to move on. And here's what she said, if I may share it with you. She said, the fact that your son in his 29 days probably brought more people to his knees in prayer on his behalf makes me feel like, you know, he's done that more than most people would ever do in their lifetime. And when she said that, it clicked that his mission on this plane was 29 days. That was it. That was his mission. Mine has lasted so far 55 years. So I need to get busy. You know what I mean? What's my purpose? What am I supposed to be doing? It got me very seriously thinking about what I was supposed to be doing, what was my purpose on earth, and when was my mission going to be accomplished, and that this was a portion of my life. This was his mission, and it was accomplished, so he was called back. Mine is still here, so I still have work to do, and I think that's why I'm so passionate about it, to let people know that you can't stop at that death or that loss because you're still here. You still have purpose. So find a passion, find out what that is, and live it. Because if you don't, you're not shortchanging your life. You're shortchanging the world because we all have our place in this world. And if you don't do it, if it's calling to you and you don't do it, we're missing a piece. Right.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Wow, just from a short conversation that they were able to help you make sense of it all and to inspire you for the future. And it's amazing how a brief interaction with somebody can really change your life.
Right. And that's what I try to do now, is just to give people things to think about that might change it for them. You know, a lot of times we're all saying the same thing. It's just sometimes you need to hear it where you are in time. And how you hear it. It can make the difference.
I will say that you definitely have been working towards that goal for a long time. Just your openness on the radio. How many people, and you'll never know this, but how many people have listened to you on the radio talk about something personal or something that you may not have even thought you were talking about a current event, but the way you formulated your idea helped them through a moment. Life, and they've even changed their life.
Right.
And you'll never know that.
You never know.
But
right.
I would have to say, just because it was so personal on something that was so hard, that had to help a lot of people throughout the years.
I hope so.
Just know, and just even them seeing you go on with your life, and here you are, you and Lola are able to laugh, have a great conversation, and have a full life, and that your life doesn't.
Right.
So I think you're continually working towards that.
I do my best. Do my best.
It probably sounds like it kind of even helped make sense of this death. That it was a mission and it was fine. Mm-hmm. That it was a short-term mission. That's a great way to look at it. Because I know when my mom passed away when I was 19, I had the opposite thing. I rarely talk about it to this day. I did talk about it once on the podcast with Tara David. You know, most of the people that know me probably forget or they don't realize that because it's just not something that I've ever been able to talk about. Well, so I kind of admire the fact that you can be as open about that as possible. Maybe it's a guy thing.
I think a guy thing is probably accurate. I don't talk. My husband doesn't talk about it nearly as much as I do. And, you know, and maybe that was a way of me healing, and it was very cathartic for me to share.
I definitely think probably talking about it is healthier or not.
Yeah.
And it's one of those things, I'm getting older now, but sooner or later, I think I'll
You will. And let me tell you this. You cannot, people in this country and in this time, day and age, don't deal with grief. And I have to tell you, I don't know that I necessarily dealt with grief either. You can't go over, you can't go under, you can't go sideways, you have to go through. You have to go through. And I think for many, many years, I kept that on the back burner.
Yeah.
I'll grieve later. I'll get there later. I don't have time for this now, whatever, you know, because it's painful. It's gut-wrenching. And let me tell you what, I talked about it openly, which was cathartic, but I did not deal with it until recently. I did not deal. I was put on antidepressants during my son's illness and was on them for 13 years. So I felt honestly that there was something stuck down inside of me that just needed to come out. I knew that I had not grieved properly. I knew it. It was under the surface. I still was able to maintain. I think that the antidepressants, you know, wouldn't allow me to go there. But at the same time, what all brought it back up was I went off the antidepressants. I started doing a lot of personal development work, which, I mean, was wonderful. I went on an incredible brain supplement that helped me as well. And then my son was leaving for college. And all of a sudden, these feelings of loss started coming up from him leaving, of all this unresolved loss. And I went through something called the grief recovery method. And it was incredible. It was an intense 8-week program that you had to go deep. You had to go there. You had to go there. But literally, when I was done, it was life-changing.
Wow.
Life-changing. And I would highly recommend it to anyone, because you can recover from grief. You can heal. People say, you know, oh, you know, that there will always be. You can heal. 100% heal, just like you can heal. Like you get a cut in your skin and it heals over, you can heal from grief.
You kind of have to get to the belly of the beast and confront it.
Yeah.
Right?
And if you're not willing to do that,
yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's a high mountain to climb.
Yeah.
I'm good at most things. I like to be honest with myself about this is the way the world is, not the way I wish things were. But there's certain mountains that I keep saying some other day. I think I'm probably maybe prepared to climb some of these mountains just because I climb smaller ones a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that's the big one for me. And you know, maybe after talking to you, maybe that's part of our journey that we came here today.
Yes, I'll tell you a wonderful, beautiful person to follow on Facebook. Permission to Mourn is a book that he wrote. His name is Tom Zuba, and his book was given to me by Bamford Exley in Wheeling, and after he knew that I was writing my book, and it was the best book on grief I have ever read in my entire life. And if you follow him on Facebook, it's his life's mission now to help people. He gives them a new way to grieve, a new, you know, permission to mourn. It's a new way to heal. And he would be someone to follow because I think his words, they're just not only beautiful, but so healing, so healing. It's one of the best books I've ever read on grieving. I would highly recommend it to anyone.
I'm taking a trip to Ireland and getting about a month. Mm. And I'm looking for something to read on the plane, so I have to pick that up.
And he writes almost poetic. And I told him, I was talking to him last week, I said, you write poetically, and I don't like poetry, but I love your book. I mean, I'm not a fan of poetry. I guess I don't have volumes of poetry.
Yeah.
I shouldn't say I don't like poetry, but yeah. But I, oh my gosh, he just, yeah, it's incredible, incredible. His story's incredible. Anyway, I digress. I'm sorry. Yes.
It'll take them to your book. Before we get into that, I want to ask you one more question.
Sure, please.
About a new supplement for the brain. brain? Is it like a nootropic? Because I'm kind of interested in those things.
Oh no, it is. It's a pure. It was designed at Signum Biosciences out of Princeton University. There's a doctor there named Dr. Jeffrey Stock. He's so famous, he has a building on Princeton's campus named after him. And he found this correlation years ago that coffee drinkers, as we sit here and drink our coffee, have less incidences of Alzheimer's disease. And he wanted to find out why. And he realized that it's that, you know, like you have that brain fog in the morning,
right.
You know, and, once I get my coffee, and everybody thinks it's the caffeine that brings that focus, that mental alertness, and clears the fog. It's not. It's this molecule in the coffee called EHT. Well, he's been able to extract that from the coffee bean and put it in this supplement. It's all natural, and it has high doses of vitamin D and magnesium, selenium, all these things. But people that are on it are able to focus better. Their memory is improved. Their cognitive function is better. As we age, these things happen, and that's part of the aging process. So this helps fortify those neuronal connections in your brain and keep them stronger. So...
because that's something interesting. I take 5-HTP usually before a podcast because it's similarly it's supposed to help. Maybe not as great as that. And I definitely am very interested in what I put into my body these days as I'm getting older. Right now, I'm going to actually be in a movie for the first time. So I
really?
Wait, so I've been drinking kale smoothies, which are disgusting, but pulverized kale and spinach and carrots and cucumbers and all these other things, they go straight into your bloodstream and your body, and it's like a B12 shot.
Yes.
And I find it when I have a whole spectrum of vitamins and minerals in my body, I feel like a million bucks, and I really don't even get that hungry, except for empty stomach hungry.
Right.
It's craving a deficiency hungry.
Absolutely. I've got something for you for that, too.
Oh, good.
Yeah. You mix it with water, and it's delicious.
Yeah. I think as we get older...
you have to pay attention to those things, yeah.
And it helps you... I have to go to the gym 4 or 5 times a week and do CrossFit with people in the CrossFit.
God bless you. That scares the bejesus out of me.
I would say anybody that wants to do it can do it.
Yeah.
Not easy, but it's also...
it's worth it, though, right?
I was explaining to a new person the other day, not only do you get the health benefit physically, but you're faced with a tough challenge 4 or 5 times a week that ordinarily you would think, I can never do that. Some days I even go, I don't know how I'm going to get through this hour, but your coaches and your friends, they get you through it, and you walk out there with a sense of accomplishment. And I go to 5 a.m. class, so by 6 a.m., I'm going to work, while other people are just kind of going, like, I've already done.
Amazing thing. Yeah.
And I feel like I'm head and shoulders above everybody else, which I'm not, but in certain ways.
I get that. Yeah, I totally get that.
I start off the day feeling like a champ. And just the self-confidence that you get from knowing that you can do tough things and that you don't have to quit. And you just build mental toughness.
Yeah, especially... when you've not done that before. I've not done that before. I've just now, in my 50s, have taken that on.
Yeah.
You know, and it's amazing.
Yeah. I never was a gym person. And it's, and we're kind of lucky in that regard because we don't have that experience. It's kind of a new thing.
Mm-hmm.
And you get to feel that satisfaction.
Right.
Finally being athletic.
Mm-hmm.
So you started working out?
I do jazzercise. I have a love-hate relationship with exercise. I just wish there was some, you know, that you didn't have to do it, but you do.
Yeah.
You know, and I know that I feel much better after I do it. I'm just trying to find something that I absolutely love, but I know what, I have this vision of what I want to look like inside of my head,
yeah.
You know, but it's just finding enough hours in the day to do everything you want to do. Isn't that crazy? And then you look back at your 20s and your 30s and you go, I wasted all that time, you know, doing things that were stupid, you know?
About the things I
ingested
in my body when I was younger. But, you know, I guess You are, how old are you?
55.
Yeah, you don't look like you're 55 yet.
Thank you.
40.
Thank you. Thank you.
Get to the gym. You might even.
Yeah, I know. I want killer arms. That's what I want.
I got decent, you know, from like, I always say, like, from like the legs down, I'm pretty good. But, you know, I have good calves, but then as you go up, it gets worse. The middle age, you know, that part, it goes slowly. But I think it's smart that you even acknowledge it. You know, you haven't really quite found the thing that you love that works because. With diet and exercise, I think a lot of times it's finding that thing that fits your lifestyle and your personality. And for me, the routine I have at the gym, they expect me to be there, so that keeps me honest.
Yes.
And I go early in the morning before work, so I get up, and before I can even think about not going, I'm there.
Right.
And then once I'm there, there's no, I think I'll just kind of do the treadmill today. No, they put me on the bike, and this is what they want.
Yes, they get you going. I think I know this about me. I know that I have to be accountable to someone else. If I'm left to my own devices, I will find a million and one excuses why not to do it. I know that about me. So I tend to do much better if I have a trainer, a coach, or accountability partner.
Well, I'm going to invite you out to Crossfire. I'm Lansing. Beth Gretchen is amazing. You and her would hit it off perfectly.
Okay.
We're just having our one-year anniversary party this weekend, and they really did change my life.
That's wonderful.
Her and Michael, my two coaches, I don't know what I would do without them. It's given me the ability to just, the confidence to do things like a podcast.
Right.
And just the physical energy to keep up with the schedule of things I want to do. So, yeah, anytime you want to come out, let me know.
Okay.
I'll get you in on the drop-in class, and just to see, I mean, believe me, you'll get a good sweat going, but you won't walk out of there going, oh, that's terrible, I never want to do it again. In fact, you'll probably fall in love with it.
Okay.
So you wrote a book.
Yes.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
So tell me the title and what it's about, and yeah.
Okay, it's called How Can I Help? Your Go-To Guide for Helping Loved Ones Through Life's Difficulties. Yeah, I wrote it about 6 years ago and had to go through a lot of my own stories inside my head to actually get to publish and release it. So the whole thought process behind it was after we lost our son, my husband and I lost some very good friends. And we were, incredibly lifted up and supported by so many people. So I don't want to act like we lived these lives very bitter against these people. But, you know, when you're going through this, there are certain people that you look for, and they weren't there. And you do wonder, well, what was that about? Well, first, you're very upset. And then through the years, you're just like, what was that about? It was incredible because people that you didn't think would even be a part of this stepped up and were amazing in helping us heal. And then there were some people that just backed away. And through the years, I was thinking about that. And, what was it? Did they not know what to do? Did they not know what to say? Did they think they were going to hurt our feelings? Did it scare them too much? What was it? Well, it could have been all of the above, or none of the above. I don't know. But I had also connected with people that the same thing was happening. Family members just disappear on them. And it was like crazy. And I thought, well, gosh, there's got to be something out there that can coach people on what you do or say. And I kept looking and kept Googling and what would, and it was not out there. And then this voice said, that's because you're supposed to put it out there. And I'm like, are you kidding me? Like, I never grew up thinking I was going to be a writer ever, but there was this need. And, so, I had flirted with this idea for a long time, and it's like, are you going to do it or are you not? And so sometimes they say if you publicly declare it, then people will hold you accountable because they'll say, well, how's that book going or whatever. So I did. I went on social media, and I said, I'm writing a book, and I need your help. who has gone through this, this, this. So it was who has suffered, you know, a loss in their life, who has gone through a divorce, who has lost their job, who has taken care of someone with a chronic illness, who has a chronic illness, who's been given a terminal illness. Can you help me? So that was me using my, so I didn't have to be a, you know, writer, so to speak. I was an information gatherer. I was a reporter, right? That's what my background was in. So I was just gathering information and compiling it in a book. And so I thought, you know what? If someone has something that they can go, okay, my friend in the next cubicle, their dad just died. I don't know what the heck to do or say. They can get this book and they can go through the list. Oh, I could do that. You know? Or, oh my gosh, my best friends are getting divorced. I don't know what to do. What am I going to say? What am I going to do? They can go to the chapter on divorce, you know? And this is not me being the expert. This is everybody who suffered that pain sharing their hearts and saying, listen, when I got divorced, my girlfriend, she came over and stayed with me every night until I wasn't afraid to stay alone anymore. You know, when my mother died, my girlfriend sent over this breakfast basket because she knew everyone was going to be bringing us stuff for lunch and dinner, but we didn't have anything for breakfast. There was juices and coffees and rolls and bagels. It was the best thing ever. It's ideas like that. People that share, this is how we were loved through it. These are the things that helped us the most. This is, and so you can take those ideas that help these people heal from that time. And you can find something that resonates with you that says, I can do that. That's simple enough.
Yeah.
I can do that. And it's a book that I'm getting so much great response from. It's amazing. It's amazing the feedback I'm getting from this.
And, you know, actually this morning I went to this place and I was asking for somebody and they said, oh, she's not here. Her sister passed away. And I didn't know what to say because mm-hmm. I don't really know either of them. But, mm-hmm. And that happens, so you're absolutely right. Especially if it's the person in the next cubicle over, you don't know them well enough to feel like that's a really gray area. How personal are you with them to be able to pin on different levels how to interact with people? Because it is, I think, a lot of times people are either afraid or they overwhelmed or it makes them fear their own mortality or their, the death of their own loved one or mm-hmm. whatever it is. And definitely not knowing what to say to a person. A friend of mine, his sister was murdered recently. And terrible for him. You know, like, he was going to come out and,
but that was good.
Yeah.
That was good. What would have been worse is that you would have just gone, oh boy, I'm not going there. I don't know what to do. Holy moly, that's scary.
Yeah,
yeah. And there are people that do that.
You know, I'd like mm-hmm. to learn more about like how to help my friend out. And I think there are definitely things that we may not think would be helpful.
Right.
From a book like yours.
Right. It does.
Yeah.
It does. And here's the thing that I've found. If you come from a place of love, you can't do anything wrong.
That's so funny that you just said that, because I was just going to say, it sounds like you wrote your book from a really good place. I want to make a bunch of money writing a book. So the book came from a good place, and that's funny that you said that, because it sounds like the book itself came from a place of love.
Yeah, it did. And I love to give this example. When I lost my son, Brandon, there was, you know, when I worked at WTOV9, a lot of times this was someone's first job.
Yes.
So they were, most people were very young, okay? So we had this young man that had just started at the station. He knew that I lost my son. He knew it was very painful. He had probably never dealt with a funeral before. And I didn't have a viewing for my son. So we just had a private viewing for family, and then we had a funeral mass. So we were coming out of mass, getting ready to go into the limousine, and here he is standing outside of church in front of the limousine with a potted plant to give to me. Okay? Now, by every, that was not the quote-unquote proper thing to
do,
but oh my gosh, how touching was that? to me. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Was it a little awkward? Yes. But have I ever forgotten that beautiful gesture? Never, ever have I forgotten that.
Wow.
I mean, it was just so heartfelt because he was just standing there with this pot going, I care, you know, I'm thinking about you. I don't even know what to do here. Have a plant. You know what I mean? But, oh, my gosh, that meant so much to me. You know, still all these years later. So that's what I'm saying. By technical standards, okay, maybe that was wrong. You know, I don't even want to say wrong. In my book, I don't even say wrong. I say not so helpful. You know, not non-traditional. Yeah. But he stepped out in love. And that's all you need to know. It's all you need to feel. He made me feel that, it was personal. Yeah.
Because I think calling the florist, and it's very nice to have them send flowers to the funeral home.
It is nice.
Very nice. But, that just the fact that that had been a very awkward moment for him, a very, you know, he doesn't know what to do, and for him to have the bravery to stand there and be willing to, you know, kind of open himself up.
Right.
Just to try to help you in any way that he could.
That's
a pretty special guy there. That's incredible.
Yeah. And so I don't know, but it just really stood out in my mind. And so, like I always say, there's really nothing. If you step out in love, in honest, good love, not just a gesture to check it off your list, then there's nothing you can do or say that's going to be bad.
You know, I was talking to Jason Kegler from We Want, and he was kind of telling me how he got the idea for We Want and how it started. And the same thing, you know, he's coming from a really good place. And I said, you can't leave, man. You're trying to build a community and trying to do something good. And I really, that's exactly how I live my life. I don't always meet that goal. But I do think that we were talking earlier about how I think the podcast can be and things like that. And just the fact that it's been really successful. And I think maybe... the fact that it's done better than I thought is because that I'm not ever trying to do gotcha. And I'm not,
right.
I'm not really even trying to.
And while I have you here, let me tell you this.
I think the fact that I enjoy it and enjoy the conversation with people, I hope that's what comes through. It does. In authenticity seems to show, and it's almost hard to cover up. Anything that you do from a good place, people notice. Even I know one day when I was volunteer at the hospital when I first moved back here, while I was looking for a job, and just woke up in a really good mood that morning, and one of my jobs there was delivering mail, and I mean, I was fantastic mood. And as I would walk through the door of these different doctor's offices to deliver the mail, people that normally wouldn't even look up, they're like, hey, it's so good to see you today. We were wondering when you were going to come in. And they would greet me with a snub. It's like they were looking at the door before I even walked in. It was a weird feeling.
Huh.
Like I was throwing some kind of an energy out there.
Right.
And that day, I still remember. That was probably 6 years ago that I was putting some kind of vibe out there, and it was totally coming back.
And
to me.
I know. And don't you want to just constantly put that vibe out?
Yeah. And it ever since then, it's reminded me that if I'm in a bad mood or if I'm, you know, that my mood will affect the way people react to me. And sometimes they say that if you smile, eventually you'll feel happy. And sometimes I just make myself smile.
Yeah.
And I always try to look at the positive side of things. And there's got to be some good, something that comes out of it. And sometimes you don't know until years later. I never wanted to live here. I always wanted to move away.
Me too.
And it's kind of odd circumstances that brought me back. I was going to come back for a few months, maybe a year. And that was in 2000. And now I can't imagine living anywhere else. I love the country. I like the people. I like the job that I like.
You get to
podcast where there's not 50 other people doing the podcast in town, and you get to make movies where there's other people doing it. But small groups, so you know, we get a good group of actors and locations and some notoriety from our tiny little films. And I mean, it's a supportive community, and So the book, how long did it take you from the time you started to the first? It was probably a pretty long process.
Actually, I put everything together and then put it on a shelf. I didn't know what to do because, like I said, I wasn't an author, so to speak. So I was like, okay, so I wrote this book. I followed the voice, the calling to write this book, and then I didn't know what to do. And actually, Craig Cargis, I went to one of his book signings, and I noticed that he had some books that were with a publisher, and he had this last one that was written was self-published. And I said, why self-published? He said, if you have a choice, he said, here's the difference. When you have a publisher, they give you kind of like, they pay for the process and then they promote your book, but you get less from it. And you don't have the control over it. If they decide there's no more printings, there's no more printings. If you self-publish, you have all the control and you make more money, but you have to pay all the costs up front. So I'm like, oh boy, I think I want to self-publish. Well, I was working 2 hours a day in local radio. So trying to come up with the money was one hurdle. But then just what do you do? What do you do? What do you follow? I started my own business in that time. And this is just like the craziest story of saying yes. Okay. So finally it was like, I'll start this business so that I can get the money for the publishing. Right. So I start the business and really get into the business and start, you know, making money and growing my business and all happy. And then the voice is like, hey, you got a book. This is what you were supposed to be doing. Yeah. And so I'm like, okay, but I still don't know what I'm doing. Well, there's a woman who's in our business who wrote two of the Chicken Soup for the Soul books.
Oh, wow.
And she's a New York Times bestselling author. And the little voice inside my head says, well, this is the person you need to contact. And then the small version of myself said, are you freaking kidding me? She is going to laugh you off the face of the earth. And so it took me probably a good 2 or 3 months to battle the voice and just contact her. And when I did, she was very gracious, but she said, listen, I closed that part of my life down. I do this now. I do this business strictly, but I have a friend who still does this, and she wrote three of the Chicken Soup for the Soul books.
Oh, wow.
And I know she's really busy right now working on a huge project, but I think your book might be small enough that she could fit it in. So then it's like, oh, hell no, I'm not calling this woman. And so but did the battle of the voices again, trying to play it small. Because, see, your human instinct wants to keep you safe.
Yeah.
And if you don't reach out for that big thing, don't put yourself out there. Because, so this is where I'm trying. It's trying to keep me safe. And the voice keeps coming. You need to call her. So I called her. And she's like, oh, your book's only this long? How many words are was it? And I don't remember. And I told her this number. I said, I think it's about this many. And she said, I should be able to do that. No problem. Send it to me by next Friday. I want it sent in this format, yada, yada, yada. Well, I go back. So self-sabotage. So I do want even better. So I'm like, okay. Then I'm scared because now she's really going to look at my stuff.
Yeah.
And so then I go back and realize that I told her the wrong number of words.
Yeah.
And so then I write her this little email, so stupid, and I said, I told you that my book was 20,000 words. I'm just paraphrasing, but it's actually only 17,000. I am so sorry. If this is unprofessional and you'd rather not work with me, I'd understand. Like, what the hell, right? And she's like, no, that's even better. I'll have more time. Send it. So I sent it, and I literally prayed over it. I'm like, God, this was your idea. So, okay, now I've done everything. I've contacted. I said yes. I'm sending it off, and do with it what you will. So she, I sent it off at 4:30 on a Friday, and I'm sitting up in Pittsburgh at a training, and it's 2:00 and we have a lunch break, and I'm just checking my emails, and she sent me this email, and she said, I got your manuscript last night, and she said, I want to tell you, she says, I've already read it, and I've already worked on it.
Wow.
And I'm telling you what, I never work on weekends. Yeah. Your book is fabulous.
That's awesome.
And I'm like, oh my gosh, I got chills from it, you know? She said, this is a beautiful thing that you're doing. So that was my first validation that it needed to be put out in the universe, right? And from there, we worked together to find the layout artist. And then he sends me, during the process, a letter that said, I had to stop working on your book so I could read your book because my wife lost her father suddenly and I didn't know what to do. And I had to read it, and it helped us both so much. And then a month later, he said, oh my gosh, my next client, my newest client, is writing a book about losing her daughter. Your book has been so helpful to me. Wow. So before it was even out, it was helping people.
Awesome.
You know what I mean? So I knew that had I not said yes, had I not listened to that voice, there's people that already were helped by it. So that's where I'm thinking, you can't play it small in life. If you have these voices that are telling you to do something, by golly, you better do it, because it wasn't about me. It was about helping other people, right? And they wouldn't have been helped if I would have still been playing, no, I can't contact her, she might laugh at me. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It was way bigger than me. It's not about me.
Yeah. You're putting something out there that's being channeled through you, maybe even.
Yeah. I truly believe.
It's not up to you to decide.
Right.
It can't be channeled. Then
you just have to say yes.
Yeah.
To step up to your life's calling, say yes. And the doors will open up.
I think that so often people are afraid to try things because they don't want to fail. And I'm like marginally talented at anything, but it's never stopped me from trying, because I'll learn on the way and I'll fail. And I hope that people listening to this will get that the importance of trying, even if you fail.
Yeah.
I know when I've written a script, and the first time you give it to somebody to read, and I'm just giving it to my friends, that's nerve-wracking. I can't imagine how nervous it would be to send a book that you've written to someone that's already written three really popular books.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I made it a part of my... I think the fact that I wasn't a writer, I think that that was a big thing, because I didn't have to be attached to it, because I knew I wasn't an author. I knew I wasn't a writer. Yeah, so it's like, I'm not attached to this. If you can capture my voice and my message, that's what I want. I wanted to share something with you that I posted on Facebook, because I think that it was from Tony Robbins. I posted it yesterday, okay? And it's exactly what we're talking about. Live life fully while you're here. Experience everything. Take care of yourself and your friends. Have fun. Be crazy. Be weird. Go out and screw up. You're going to anyway, so you might as well enjoy the process. Take the opportunity to learn from your mistakes. Find the cause of your problem and eliminate it. Don't try to be perfect. Just be an excellent example of being human.
Yeah, that's great.
You know, so... you can't fail if you live that way.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
I heard someone, they said that there's winning and there's learning. There's no winning.
Yeah.
There's winning and learning. And that helped me a lot, too, the idea that, well, some of these podcasts, I had one where we were running off the battery power, and it died the first 20 minutes,
yeah.
And we lost it. Sorry, Corey Roth. But I didn't give up, and I just kept going. We were talking earlier that almost 6,000 downloads, and I expected maybe 500. Well, I'm glad I took a shot.
Yes.
And overcoming that voice in your head, I think that everybody has. And I think for people listening to this, that they might be surprised. Oh, Sherrie McCutcheon, she's been on TV and on the radio, and very confident person. They probably would have never thought in their minds that you would be someone that might not be confident.
I battle with that daily.
Yeah, I think everybody does. And I think it's good for people
But do it anyway. Yeah.
There was a book a long time ago. Someone did it. I went into couples therapy when I was like 22. Which now I look back, it's kind of silly. But after that, I stayed for another year and had regular therapy, which taught me a lot. One of the books that they gave me was a book called Feel the Fear and Do It Anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And just the title alone, I don't remember much about the book, but I do remember the title. It's that, you can't let your fears hold you back.
Right. So many people do. So many people do. Well, I've tried to really build a speaking career. That's what I'm passionate about. I want to get this message across to people that, step out of that fear so that you can step into your greatness. Those stories that we tell ourselves, it's BS. It's really just trying to keep you safe. Well, safe from what? Safe from this vibrant life that's out there waiting for you. It's there if you just go for it. It might not work out every time, but you're learning your way through it. And it's a journey. It's a venture, right?
Yeah. And it is about the experience.
Mm-hmm.
And I think even, sadness is part of life's experience. And even though, I don't want to be sad all the time. But I have an appreciation for it, because I think it makes you appreciate being happy. And I think just to experience the broad range of human emotions is important. So I think maybe if nothing else, that helps me get through the bad times, because I realize that it's a part of having a rich life.
Right.
So I don't necessarily enjoy it. I don't hate it either.
Right.
And the ability to keep going. Now, public speaking, they say that's the biggest fear, even that you've got to be the person in the casket than the person giving the eulogy, because it's a greater fear than dying. Obviously, from being on TV and radio, you're a bit more comfortable with that.
I never was. Oh my gosh, I never was. Yes, it's in front of people.
Yeah.
See, when I'm in front of a microphone or a camera, I can't see if people are falling asleep or screaming back at the camera or criticizing me. But you can see the person asleep. You can see the people talking on the side when you're live. Or you're losing them, or they're not interested, or they're getting angry. That judgment. I was afraid of that judgment. And I would remember being asked to speak as I was younger, and I thought, what the heck do they want to hear from me? What could I possibly tell these people? Well, now I have so much I want to tell people that it's like I will get in front of anybody.
Yeah.
I will get in front of anybody, because I just feel it's so important, and I wish that I had this when I was younger. I wish I had this mindset when I was younger, and I just feel like, and I want people that are even, there's no cap on this, especially the older you are. If you think your life is over, you're crazy. You still have purpose on this earth, and you can still contribute and make this world a better place, So I don't ever plan on retiring. I plan on making this my mission in life now. It's too fun.
I think we're lucky that we've been able to find things for the kind of people that appreciate being busy and doing things and finding things that we're passionate about, and then it doesn't feel like work,
right?
And I think to be able to speak publicly, now that you've found something that you want to talk about, that you feel passionate about, it's going to be so much easier than if you just decided as a business venture, I'm going to be a motivational speaker, and then you had to come up with a routine.
Mm-hmm.
But when
what's going to be my hook?
When you're coming from the other side,
it's organic.
And you have to speak to people because you want to get the information out there. It's going to make you a much better speaker and more comfortable on stage, because imagine once you get over that initial hi, hello, and you start talking about the thing that you're passionate about.
We won't be able to shut you up. Yeah.
You'll have plenty to say. And he was great. I think it's incredible that you had really now three careers.
I know. But that's what I'm saying is that, you know, you don't have to pigeonhole yourself into something. And I always like to talk to people that, you know, maybe they thought their mission was raising their children. There's still so much to you.
Maybe.
But now there's a new chapter. So come on.
Go to the gym in the morning, and then I'm off to go to the kitchen and help eating. But for a lot of people, they don't even know that I'm in bed. And then some people, all they know is all I talk about is motorcycles. And then the podcast and filmmaking. And so I definitely don't, you know, from time to time, my brain will be focused on one thing or another, but it definitely jumps around. And I feel lucky that I have a really diverse set of interests that aren't really even related to each other.
Right.
And this was all, you know, up to the age of 30 that I started to get interested in things. And so, yeah, at any age, I mean, I didn't buy my first motorcycle until I was 45.
And, wow.
You know, probably my favorite thing about filmmaking and podcasts and anything. And this I just started, you know, after the first year, and it's another path of mine. So
you're saying yes to life, and isn't that wonderful? Yeah.
And try things.
So, but how many people would say, "Oh, I'd like to try. I'll never work. No one will listen. No, you know, there's what? So what? So what?
Try it. Yeah. I've had so many people say they always wanted to do a podcast. I'm like, just do it.
Right.
You don't need even all this equipment. Put an iPhone on a table and talk to somebody, and you get it recorded. Come to me, and I'll help you put it online. Or just post it anywhere.
Yeah.
There's no reason to not try.
Absolutely. Start saying yes to life. You know, it's fun. Make it fun. Yeah. Don't make it think of win or lose or, you know. I love how you say yes to life. I think I want to try this. And you just don't, and the voices are going to come. I'm sure that your voices are like, oh, but you do it anyway. So what? I'm going to do it anyway. And it's going to be fun. You know, I had a friend that also helped me look at this. He taught me that when you're going through something bad, just look at it as a war story. Try to make it just a part of your journey. And now you have a war story to tell.
Yeah. It makes for a more interesting life. And even now, you'll be up in Pittsburgh and you're lost or something. And you'll say, one day this is going to be a funny story. Right?
Yeah.
It sucks. But,
yeah.
My brother, you know, he's kind of jokes around. Like, when I say, hey, I think I might want to get a motorcycle, oh, you're getting a motorcycle. I think I might want to start a podcast. Yep. It might take a year before I finally get around to having the mojo to do it. But I think, and to me, I feel like that's been a gift. And I'm given with that personality that I do take the leap that others don't, so it doesn't make me special. It's just something that I inherited from my parents, or I don't know where it came from, but I know that it's not easy for people to do it, and I'm lucky that to some extent it does come easy to me.
This thought just came to me. Most people live from a state of why? Yeah. Why? Yeah. And you live from a state of why not?
Why not? Yeah. Because actually, early on, when I the first time I ever mentioned doing a podcast, and you see 10,000 podcasts out there, why would anybody want to listen to another one? I'm like, and I thought about that for a while. I'm like, yeah, they're probably right. And then I thought, well, maybe nobody will listen to it. But that's no reason to not do it.
That's right. You can't. You know, Brené Brown, Dr. Brené Brown, wrote a wonderful book, and in it, she's talking about, you know. If you aren't willing to get in the ring and get muddied and bloodied and dirty, then I'm not interested in your comment on the sidelines.
Yeah.
You know, if you're not going to hop in the ring and do it, then your opinion does not matter to me. And I love that because it's so easy to sit from the sidelines and criticize everybody else. It really is. And I don't have time for that anymore.
Yeah, it just weighs you down.
Mm-hmm.
I guess when I enter into anything, I always have like the highest aspirations to be the best, but also have like lowest expectations of realistically what it will be. So anywhere that I land in the middle, I'm fine. I thought, well, Joe Rogan, he gets about 10 million downloads per episode. I'd like to get 11 million. But if I get like five, that was my, literally my goal was 5 to 10 per episode. So anywhere in the middle there, I'm okay with. And I think it's been really helpful for me however it turns out, I did the best I could.
But look at what you've gained along the way. How many relationships have you really gone into? You know, like the interviews that you've had. How richer is your life for knowing these people and their stories, you know?
Because after that, I mean, we bonded over this last hour. And so, and same with a lot of the other guests, people that were in my life that I didn't know that well. Even good friends of mine that have come on the podcast. The conversation that we would never ordinarily have with. That it advances the friendship a lot. And even though, you know, with the filmmaking, being able to work with really talented people and spend time with them, not just hanging out at a bar or going out to dinner, but when you work together collaborating on a project, you bond in a way that you just don't.
Right.
I recently kind of had a new way of looking at independent films, and I based it off of Soundgate, where they're providing an opportunity for people to be on stage and be involved in theater, and also producing excellent plays. I mean, the plays were high end. But another goal besides good entertainment is providing people with
opportunity.
So I see that, you know, we're probably never going to make a movie that will take Hollywood by storm, but what we can do is give people here in the High Valley an opportunity to be involved in making a movie, whether acting or being on a crew or something. And to me, that's the real value of what we're doing.
It is.
That's where I get the most joy. Because it's hard to make a movie look flawless. We do the best we can. So I just think that the experience of making it has what counts.
And you're still a filmmaker.
Yeah,
you know, so many people stop. That's what I always like to tell people, too. You know, just because you can't necessarily make a living at it doesn't mean that you should stop doing it. And that's what I love about the arts community here is that, you know, there are very few people that are making their living at the arts, but there are very many people who are still incorporating the arts into their life. You know, if you want to act, act. If you want to make films, make films. If you want to sing, sing. You know, you don't necessarily, that's what brings your life richness and joy, you know, and you don't necessarily, it doesn't make you less of a singer because you're not on a top 40 record, you know, or on the chart. You know, you might make your living as, you know, a nurse, a barista, you know, but do the things that make your heart sing. Do them anyway. Don't stop. So many people stop.
Yeah, or they think that unless they're the best, then it's not worth it.
Yeah.
And my friend Ben Thompson was a potter. He still is. And he worked at the farm restaurant. He said he liked working at the farm because then he could make whatever pots he wanted. He didn't have to worry about whether they sold or not. And they always did because he was great. But, you know, I kind of like my job at the hospital because my bills are paid. So there's no pressure for any of the other things I do to be successful or even make money. In fact, I think I probably spend about $400 a year for the hosting service and for this podcast. But I don't have to worry about how well the show isn't good if it doesn't get enough downloads.
Right. And you don't have stress involved with it. It's just all joy.
And I think, you know, I've just been playing music before, but I've seen the band once, and it started to do pretty well. And then we started making some money, and I don't say that it totally corrupted everybody, but then you start looking at the door and you're like, how much are we going to make tonight? And that's not what you should be thinking about when you're playing music. And you know, if you get to a level where the money's covered, you don't care, but we're kind of at that mid-level. And so even as far as like, I think giving advertisers, and then I just feel like, if anybody wants to advertise on the show, please contact me.
To go after them. Yeah, it's just not your...
Yeah, and I think it would be hard for me to...
That's where it'd be nice to collaborate with someone. Someone who's a marketing genius and just loves to have success stories,
yeah,
you know? Cut them in on it. You know, if you could come up with some kind of deal, you help me market, and you know, then we'll split it.
And that's
you know?
Art.
Yeah, that's their art, right.
And,
yeah.
And, well, so Ben's wife, Melanie, she's a painter, and she said that creative people like painters, they meet people that are not necessarily artists, whose art is support and promote the arts.
And to buy the art.
Yeah.
Yes.
And there are a lot of people out there that didn't like it, that's painter, but they love it enough to come.
Mm-hmm.
I think your story is incredible. You've overcome a lot of things and different careers. And to start something new and not be afraid to is very inspiring. And just the fact that you're part of this DIY movement that a lot of people are with.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than go through the traditional route of a publisher or a record label or even a radio station for a podcast, to just do it yourself and kind of retain the control. You may not make $1 billion, but the money that you do make, you earned it all yourself. And you get to release it exactly how you want it to do. And it rises or falls on its own merits. And
mm-hmm.
that's a really cool thing. And I also think that success is more and more being measured, not in millions of dollars, but can you have a lifestyle that's comfortable and make enough money just to do that?
Mm-hmm.
And not necessarily have 5 houses.
Yeah, I don't want to mess with all that stuff.
Yeah.
I've become more minimalistic. Yeah. I'd rather have experiences than things.
I think just enough money to not struggle.
Yeah.
If you have enough money to not struggle and you get to do that, make that money doing something you love, I think that's like the ultimate success. Not making it those.
Yeah, that's you're in the zone.
Yeah. Yeah. If you can live comfortably doing the work you love,
a life well lived.
So if people want to get in touch with you, Facebook, obviously?
Facebook. My professional page is Sherrie Dunlevy. I went with my married name, so that's and my book is published under Sherrie Dunlevy. You can go to sherriedunlevy.com. That talks about me as an author, speaker, and an entrepreneur. And my book is available, I know, at the Artisan Center, at Words and Music, Amazon.com. And if you want a personalized signed copy, you can just contact me, SherrieDunlevy.com or SherrieDunlevy@gmail.com.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And I'm sure a lot of people will be contacting you. So you're putting something really good out there that a lot of people need. And I'm just proud to know.
Thank you.
I'm so glad that you came on. And
I'm so glad you had me on. I just wanted to pick your brain about something, and you said, would you do a podcast? And I'm like, yes. Love it.
Honestly, we're talking about, you were nervous about sending out your book. I would have been too nervous to ask you because, you did radio for a living. This is a little podcast. So I was very honored that you
My pleasure. My pleasure. Thank you.
It's been a lot of fun. And I think we'll talk a little bit more about the podcast world and stuff here once we finish recording. But thank you so much for coming on. And for everybody that listened, thank you so much and for continuing to listen. And we were talking earlier that the show is being listened to, downloaded outside the country in probably 20 different countries.
Wow.
Yeah, if there's someone overseas that happens to hear the show, look me up on Facebook and just send me a message and let me know how the heck you found out about the podcast. And any suggestions, please be kind. But yeah, critiques, anything, I'm always looking for it, and especially always looking for new and interesting guests, people that I don't necessarily know. By all means, send me a message and let me know if you'd like to come on. All right, hey, thanks again.
Thank you.
Thank you guys for tuning in. We'll see you. Go on thinking
nothing's wrong. But who's gonna drive you home tonight? Who's gonna pick you up when you fall? Who's gonna hang it up when you call? Who's gonna pay attention to your dreams? Yeah, who's gonna plug their ears when you? Nothing's wrong. Who's gonna drive you home tonight? Gonna hold it down when you